knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
As we saw in the previous tutorial, the birth of Western philosophy was characterized by attempting to understand nature and the world around us through reason rather than myth, an endeavor that began with Thales and his Milesian school. They influenced much of later philosophy until today, starting with the Eleatic school, founded by Parmenides around the 5th century BCE, named for its region of Elea, near current Velia in Italy. They were especially influenced by Xenophanes in attempting to understand the nature of knowledge itself. Their perspective on existence was that, much like their predecessors, everything in existence was composed of a single substance. This is called monism. However, this one substance is eternal, indivisible, stagnant, and formless, and isn't perceived by our physical senses. Thus, empirical analysis was invariably false, and nothing became or ceased to be, as everything was and always will be part of the one. Perceived change is but a mistake, and only abstract intuition can adequately guide our understanding of the world, since our thought is the same as our being. Thus, for them, everything we can think of is real, for we cannot conceive of things that do not exist, as even the most extreme conjecture must be in some form part of the one. His student, Zeno, also from Elea, attempted to prove this by what we might refer to today as destroying his opponents with facts and logic, or invariably fallacious arguments, reductio ad absurdum, as we will encounter in a future tutorial, devised for public performance rather than serious philosophical debate. His best-known example to disprove the existence of movement was that in order to move from point A to point B, one must traverse to the halfway point between these. And from this point to point B, there's also a halfway point. Thus, if we are to always divide the distance between two points by two, no matter how small the number is, it will never be zero. According to him, this mathematically proves that movement is but an illusion of the senses, as one can never actually reach point B. This is currently known as Zeno's paradox, or the dichotomy paradox. Some critics of early monists were the pluralists, which imagined not a single substance for all of reality as their predecessors did, but rather a combination of many. They were strongly influenced by Parmenides, adapting his theory into their own. Anaxagoras believed that four elements composed everything, those being water, earth, wind, and fire, mixing and separating to create different appearances, but also believed in many others, such as blood, darkness, or even denseness, which were eternal and manifested in the mixtures themselves according to their proportions. To him, everything began in a limitless amalgam, being moved into different states by a mind, a separate cosmic entity, thus generating the sun, stars, and land masses, and also the cycles of life and weather. Since their causes are clear and analogous, as the same principle and contents can be found in anything, we could tell reality from mere appearances with proper rational analysis. Empedocles, on the other hand, believed in only the four elements, which he called roots, which were blended and separated by the forces of love and strife. He was so confident in this understanding that he offered recipes to create bones, skin, and other parts of the anatomy with different amounts of these two forces. Clearly, his cosmological perspective was intertwined with an ethical and epistemological one, as knowledge arose not only from understanding these principles, but also from embracing and enacting them within one's own life. The pluralist perspective set the stage for the first historic formulation of the atomic theory. The Abdera school, with its former namesake city near current Abdera, Greece, arose by criticizing the Eleatic conception of an unchanging whole by first introducing what would eventually evolve to be the current understanding of an atom. Democritus, its most famous member, posited that everything was composed of uncountable, minuscule, indivisible, and eternal particles of existence, imperceptible to human senses, located in and separated by vacuum, or the void. These atoms had different shapes, and they moved, collided, and occasionally joined, given their various formats in this nothingness, shaping everything we know. Thus, every object is merely a socially constructed convention of different arrangements of several atoms. This would also be a response to Zeno, since indivisible parts could, according to Democritus, denote movement. Of course, this notion of the atom was purely hypothetical and largely metaphysical, but it is fascinating how a 2,500-year-old supposition somewhat resembles our current scientific understanding of matter. Other than those advanced ideas, they also thought Earth was a flat cylindrical drum in the cosmos, and vortices of atoms would burn and create the sun and stars at its edges. Other minor sorts of atomism developed throughout ancient times, even with other thinkers like Plato, but only Epicurus gave it significant attention, as we will see briefly later in the series. The last of the inquirers into nature, named as such because Aristotle marked the Presocratics as being concerned with the nature of reality, was Diogenes of Apollonia, an ancient city near current Poyan, Albania, returning to the beliefs of Anaximenes more than a century later in affirming that air was the primordial element of all existence. However, this followed the trend of more applied problems of knowledge and ethics. As we breathe air, we are governed by it. Thus, the soul and intelligence are but a manifestation of it. Proper use of intelligence is then inherently good and orders things in a good manner, according to Diogenes. Finally, the last known pre-Socratic movement was the Sophists, itinerant or wandering thinkers, speakers, musicians, mathematicians, and athletes. They were professional intellectuals hired as tutors, diplomats, or mere entertainers who taught about virtue or intellectual values which could mold one's character or even the government itself toward a better life. They were responsible for shifting the focus of philosophical inquiry toward political and ethical issues, though frequently resorting to rhetoric or embellishing their lack of knowledge, so as not to forfeit the financial support of their patrons. Plato later criticized the Sophists by contrasting them with Socrates, who would be a true philosopher, inquiring merely for the sake of knowledge rather than material gains or fame, shaping most of our perspective of them for centuries. Nevertheless, as rhetoric and argumentation were among their most prized qualities, the Sophists developed the first classifications of sentences according to their force, from wishes and questions to assertions and addresses, as well as rudimentary criteria for truth and falsehood, setting the stage for proper formal and informal logic. Much is still to be uncovered and understood regarding pre-Socratic thinkers. As new evidence appears and further analyses and translations are developed, we continue to advance in appreciating their role in the foundations of Western thought. The three pivotal philosophers of the classical period, Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, could not exist were it not for the previous development of philosophical inquiry, as is evident by their thorough commentary of it, which comprises most of the sources we have on pre-Socratic philosophy. Now that we understand some of this foundation, let's take a look at these three enormous figures in ancient philosophy, starting with Socrates and Plato, and attempt to find out why they're considered some of the most impactful thinkers in human history.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.